level or someplace where the tide came in with greater force, you had to raise your crapper higher. Sometimes as high as 12 feet. Make for an interesting skyline, don't you? Anyone have to go?
There's the street, and above you at this point is blue sky, remarkably enough. So where we were just worried, we were trying to figure out how to get across the street. But as I said, the city government, they think of everything and they spare no expense, so they kindly installed ladders at the corner of every intersection. Ladders. Let's say you're a woman in the 1890s, and you want to get across the street. Now, women in the 1890s, as I'm sure we all know, didn't tend to wear jeans or shorts as a fashion choice. Long, confining skirts and corsets, right? Go down to the corner. Balance your packages on your arm, put your parasol under your arm, hold on to your hat, hike up your floor-length skirt, and climb an 8 to 32-foot ladder. Luckily, you'd at least be safe on the way up, because often they're very thoughtful gentlemen willing to hold the bottom of the ladder for you. You gotta look both ways, cross the street, climb back down another 8 to 32-foot ladder, and continue shopping. You ever heard the phrase, shop till you drop? But if you think it was hard for the women in old Seattle, imagine the men. They were loggers or miners. They came into town was for one reason, to have a good time. Getting to the saloon was no problem. Getting home from the saloon was a little more of a problem. Actually, over 17 people lost their lives this way. You're such a compassionate group. The newspapers listed these deaths as involuntary suicides. No kidding. Cause of death, stepping from the street to the curb. We didn't have AA back then. We had a one-step program. It was kind of a big
process. All right.
First review. You're standing on the level of the original sidewalk. Behind you are the original first floor entrances to the buildings. In the doors and windows. Behind me, the street wall. Behind here, dirt, garbage, etc., etc. And up there, the street. And above you, the modern sidewalk. I want to point out this photo. This photograph was taken in about 1870. It's about 20 years after the city was founded, about 20 years before the fire. A couple interesting things about it. One, you notice there's a lot of buildings, so the city grew relatively fast in its first 20 years. Two, you notice every single one of those buildings is built out of wood. The fire waiting to happen. But I think the most interesting thing about that photo is, well, you know when you go to the mall and you see a "You Are Here" sticker on the map? If there were a "You Are Here" sticker on this map, it'd be right there. What we just did is cross this street, came down here, came down to this level. If I were in this, or if we were all in this photo, I'd be here, you'd be kind of gathered around. If you wanted to, you could look across the street, see if there's a good place to grab a cup of coffee. You can't now because there's this big brick wall in the way. And that is how the underground has created us. The seamstresses would walk above, kind of advertising, and print their address on the sole of their shoe. It's called selling your soul. It's not true. There's always a prism. Each one of those little bricks, those little panes, is a three-way prism, which lets in a lot of light down here. I mean, you folks are almost entirely lit by that. And you can't really see through it. It did, however, used to be colorless. Has anyone walked over one recently? What color are they now? Purple, exactly. That's because before World War I, glassmakers in the States used a thing called manganese to bleach the glass. What they didn't know is that after a few years, that manganese would react with the ultraviolet rays from the sun and turn purple. Of course, what takes a few years in most regions took decades in Seattle. But it did eventually turn purple, and we're proud of that because it proves we get sun. A lot of people don't believe it. So if you walk over a skylight, you notice it's purple glass below your feet. There are two things. One, that that's an original skylight beneath you, and underneath that is underground Seattle and perhaps 40 people. Straight through the middle, ran above ground, on stilts, kind of like that. Now, there are stories of people tried to make it more public, either by shooting holes in it or by holding a bucket in the ground, but eventually it was dismantled and Seattle got a true public water system. All these pipes were thrown into a big pit at the base of First Hill. In the early 1960s, they were cutting I-5 along the base of First Hill, found like 70 of these pipes. So they called up Bill Spidell, said, hey, you know what these things are? And you know what? I think I do. But why don't you cover him back up? I'll be back around, 6 o'clock to check it out. And he made some quick anonymous phone calls to the TV stations and newspapers. Those files can make a great discovery at 6 p.m. You should be there. He's there just in time to discover Seattle's original water system live on the 6 o'clock news.
Whale oil is so viscous, it's never evaporates. We'll be there for
Thank you. That is our only stop on the monorail. Once at the Westlake Center, you can walk downtown to Kavanaugh's and Fifth Avenue. Go to the Bottom Cafe. Or a Chris Steakhouse. Roy's at the Westin. Convenient walking distance to the Sheraton downtown. The Warwick. Westin. Roosevelt. You can also stroll to the waterfront at the Farmer's Market, Argosy Tours, Bay Pavilion, Seattle Aquarium. Streetcar rides along the waterfront, the Victoria River. A short trip will take you just under 2 minutes at a cruising speed of about 45 miles an hour. Yeah, round trip ticket from Seattle Center. It's good until 11 p.m. this evening to complete your round trip back from Westlake Center. Enjoy the ride.
Thank you. Thank you.